the first French woman admitted to a lodge, and the creation of the international mixed Masonic order, Le Droit Humain. The fascinating history of the international mixed Masonic order, Le Droit Humain, dates back to April 4, 1893, a crucial date in the history of Freemasonry. At that time, traditional Freemasonry did not allow the initiation of women and did not recognize their equality in Masonic rights and responsibilities. However, this order would soon challenge these conventions established for centuries. To fully understand the origins of Le Droit Humain, we must go back to the 18th century, the era of the Enlightenment, when modern Freemasonry, also known as speculative Freemasonry, emerged in England. Let's explore together the official history of this movement. On June 24th, 1717, four London lodges came together to form the first Grand Lodge, marking the beginning of organized Freemasonry. To regulate these new lodges, the Andersons' constitutions were written in 1723. These constitutions, largely the work of Jean-Théophile des Aiguillers, a French Anglican priest, defined the foundational principles of Freemasonry. However, despite these advancements, 18th century Freemasonry was not open to all. The 1723 Andersons Constitutions excluded slaves, servants, atheists, and of course women. Despite this, they expressed great tolerance for the time and emphasized the importance of brotherhood among humans. In the 19th century, the Grand Orient of France, GODF, a Masonic obedience, abolished the requirement to believe in God to become a Freemason in 1877. This decision marked the beginning of significant change in French Freemasonry. However, strict non-mixing persisted, and women were still excluded. It was at this point that Maria Deraismes, a woman of letters, journalist, speaker, feminist, and social activist, entered the scene. Born on August 17, 1828, in the 17th arrondissement of Paris, she came from a liberal bourgeois family. Her father was an anti-clerical Voltairean, and her mother was the heiress of an uncle who developed lenticular lenses. She was self-taught, learning to read through her older sister and delving into ancient literature, the Enlightenment, philosophy, and Oriental religions from a young age. At 12, she was already giving speeches and writing pamphlets and plays. Initially destined to become a painter, she received painting lessons in Nice, but eventually turned to writing after her father's death in 1852. She actively engaged in the feminist movement, co-founding societies for civil rights and women's rights. She wrote for various feminist newspapers and gave lectures on feminist themes. Starting in 1865, she was invited by brothers of the Grand Orient of France to give lectures in their lodges. She distinguished herself through her advocacy for women's and social emancipation. A group of brothers from the Grand Orient of France, including Dr. Georges Martin, advocated for the admission of women to Freemasonry. They argued that Freemasonry could not truly promote the progress of humanity while excluding half of its members. Faced with the repeated refusal of Masonic obediences to admit women, a revolutionary act occurred. The lodge Le Libre Penseur du Pec of the Grand Symbolic Scottish Lodge initiated Maria Deraismes into Freemasonry on January 14, 1882. This action openly violated the established principles of the Andersons' constitutions. However, Dissensions soon arose within the lodge, leading to the departure of several brothers. To avoid endangering the lodge that had initiated her and faced the threat of closure, Maria Deraismes ceased attending its meetings. Nevertheless, she continued to play a central role in the Masonic world by welcoming Freemasons, especially those who had supported her initiation, into her salon. For years, the question of the initiation of women continued to divide Masonic workshops. After 10 years of unsuccessful attempts, Maria Deraismes and Georges Martin decided to take a bold approach. They embarked on creating a mixed loggia, a loggia where women and men would be treated as equals as Freemasons. To do this, they gathered a group of 13 women, all initiated by Maria Deraismes. On April 4th, 1893, in a Masonic hall on Boulevard Sebastopol in Paris, they founded the Grand Symbolic Scottish Mixed Lodge of France, the world's first mixed Masonic lodge. This founding marked a decisive turning point in the history of Freemasonry. Unfortunately, Maria Deraismes passed away in 1894, but her legacy lived on. The founding members, including Georges Martin, took up the mantle and continued her work, placing Lodge Le Droit Humain, as it was later renamed, beyond national borders, religions, and cultures. At the turn of the century, Le Droit Humain rapidly expanded, creating mixed lodges in Paris, in the provinces, and then internationally. In 1901, the International Mixed Masonic Order, Le Droit Humain, was officially born with an international constitution. This was a crucial step as it allowed lodges to operate beyond national boundaries. Over the decades, this unique order continued to grow, opening its doors to new members, whether they were men or women, regardless of their background, religion, or orientation. Today, after more than 130 years, Le Droit Humain is present in more than 60 countries on 5 continents. It embodies the vision of a universal, egalitarian, and humanistic Freemasonry, continuing its commitment to tolerance, fraternity, and social justice. The legacy of the International Mixed Masonic Order, Le Droit Humain, is a story of evolution, challenges, and progress. Its founding in 1893 broke down gender barriers in Freemasonry and paved the way for a new era of Masonic inclusivity, setting a precedent for inclusion and equality in this traditionally male-dominated field. The building that houses Le Droit Humain was constructed between 1912 and 1914 by architect Charles Nizet and was originally the residence of Georges Martin. The facade of the building is adorned with palmiform columns and meaningful inscriptions. Egypt being in vogue at the time, the winged triangles that decorate it symbolize Horus. Above the main entrance, one can read the order's motto, Ordo ab chao, which we are told reminds us of the importance of order within chaos, but in reality, it conveys the opposite idea if you haven't noticed yet. Today, when some mention the sacrifice of our grandparents for our freedom, it becomes evident that they have not bothered to check the historical backgrounds of the ideas they hold on to. They simply repeat the same interpretations they have heard or read without conducting personal verifications. However, nothing is hidden. All organizations and movements that emerged after the French Revolution, which somehow officially acknowledged the existence of Freemasons, have their roots in Masonic lodges and their personal beliefs. Even freedom of speech is a concept that was encouraged and developed by the fraternity. After the French Revolution at the end of the 18th century, we saw the ideas and convictions of Freemasons flourish worldwide throughout the 19th century, giving rise to all the movements we still know today, characterized by the suffix "-ism," such as nationalism, racism, feminism, and many others. Before taking a stance in favor of an idea or a movement, it is essential to personally verify the actual meaning of the etymology of the word and understand who is behind these ideas, as well as the circumstances of their inception. As always, it should be remembered that many struggles and sacrifices were necessary to give birth to a movement. It is crucial to emphasize that Freemasonry does not truly wield power over the state or the people. It is simply another organization created by the Jesuits to absolve themselves of their responsibilities while establishing a kind of guardian who would perpetuate the missions once carried out by Jesuit missionaries. Freemasonry relies on the voice of the people, which is, in reality, our life force, so that it can influence and implement its principles and powers. As for the origin of the Masonic movement initiated by the Jesuit fathers, we will explore this topic in a future video. We will also examine in other videos the origin of the movements that emerged from Masonic lodges and imaginations. Thank you for watching, and see you soon.